welcome to another edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Today's video game based on a movie that we'll be reviewing is Disney's The Jungle Book, made in 1993, published by Virgin Interactive for the Sega Master System, and in 1994 for the Sega Game Gear. The movie, The Jungle Book, was a 1967 animated film produced and created by Walt Disney Studios, and was the 19th animated movie created by the now iconic studio. The film itself was very loosely based on the book of the same name that was written in 1894. The Jungle Book was a successful animated film for its time, taking in $73 million in its initial 1967 release in the United States. It would have a successful sequel produced in 2003, as well as various video games made from the early 1990s to the early 2000s, produced for various systems on the market during said years. This is one of the Disney films that started the trend for animated movies to get well-known voice actors to play the parts of the characters we see on the screen, providing the voice of one of the most iconic lazy bums of a bear in all movies ever made, that being Baloo the Bear, is Phil Harris. Phil was a radio star, singer, voice actor, TV star, and worked with many legends of the time. The voice of the man cub, young human boy named Mowgli, is Bruce Reitherman, who was sort of born into the part of the character due to his father being the director of the film and Bruce being the right age for the part at the time. The scatting and singing orangutan named King Louie was voiced by longtime singer Louie Prima, whose style was very similar to that of Louis Armstrong. Rounding out the who's who cast of the film are British film and TV actor Sebastian Cabot as Sirius and rule-following Bagheera the Panther, longtime actor George Sanders as the man-hating tiger and main foil of the film, Shere Khan, and voice acting icon Sterling Holloway as hungry and hypnotic snake Ka. The Jungle Book is the story of a young orphan boy named Mowgli, who is left in the care of a wolf pack in the jungle and raised as if he were one of their own. Everything is working out just fine until one night news spreads that the powerful king tiger of the jungle, Shere Khan, has returned. He wants Mowgli dead and is on the hunt for him. Bagheera takes it upon himself to get Mowgli to safety to a human village on the other side of the jungle before Shere Khan can get to him. Along the way, Mowgli meets up with lots of other jungle inhabitants, some friendly, some dangerous, and some just strange. Mowgli doesn't want to leave the only home he has ever known his whole life, and runs away from Bagheera and meets up with the carefree, lazy, do-nothing of a bear named Baloo. Two get into trouble all along the way, having to avoid snakes, monkeys, and the tiger himself. The movie is filled with many fun-filled songs, humor, great voice acting, and exciting moments that kids and adults alike should get a good kick out of in the usual Disney classic film type of nostalgia.
And here we have another dual system version of this movie-based game. This time it's for Sega's Master System and Sega's Game Gear. So, how will the 8-bit Sega version go as far as reliving Mowgli's adventure through the jungle? I'm going to tell you now as we get on to the review. Originally released on just the Sega Master System in 1993, exclusively in the European and Brazilian markets, this was the first version of the game based off of this movie found on any system, and this particular version was ported onto the Game Gear in all markets, including North America, and it's unchanged from its Master System version. For this review, since it's the same game on both versions, I'll do the original version as was found on the Sega Master System. And this version of the game will form the opinions for this review, since it's the same game in every way from what was released a year later on the portable-based system. A basic platformer with objectives, collecting of items, and boss battles mixed in for good measure. The game has 11 levels in total, with each level being separated into three types of goals. The first is collect the 8 gems scattered throughout a stage to move on to the next. The next goal type is reach Bagheera at the end of a stage to move on to the next. The last type is a boss battle, which is just you versus the enemy and you beat it to move on to the next stage. There's also a bonus stage that is just for item collecting and ends when you get hit or miss a jump. Mowgli, of course, is the only playable character in this game, with you exploring through the various areas trying to relive moments from the movie all the while. This version of the game probably has the most simplistic of load-up screens versus the other versions. It will show you the load-up information before just going to a still screen of the logo as it waits for the player to make a selection, with either starting the game or tweaking some of the options. there'll be no backstory found, no cutscenes, no nothing besides this screen. Which is understandable, as the Master System is limited on what it can do versus what these systems later are able to. The first level starts out with Mowgli standing in the jungle, having to explore about various levels and platforms, as you're on a hunt for 8 scattered orange-colored gems that you have to find in the given time limit to move on to the next level. And for this game, he has a few ways that he can navigate through the stage. There are seesaws that will catapult him up higher, vines to climb on and to move across, and vines to swing on. There's also broken step bridges that you'll have to leap across to get to some of the gems in out-of-the-way places, as well as spring plants that will trampoline him upwards to hard-to-reach platform. As is often the case in games based on this film, his main go-to weapon is that of a banana that he can fire directly in front of him to take out the various animal-based enemies scattered throughout. And of course, he can jump and pick up other items to help him along the way. If he can survive without losing all his energy in the process and collect all the gems before the time limit runs out as well, the stage is completed, and all you get for your trouble is a score tally screen. Then you move on to the second scene to do it all over again. The readouts for this game are all pushed to the corners, with 3 of the corners having a vital statistic to take note of. There are actually 2 displays in the top left corner. The first being a snake that represents your life meter. The snake starts out at full size, and for every hit you take, it'll get smaller and smaller until you lose the life. And as you can imagine, this is not a very good use for a life bar, as it was hard to tell how much energy you truly had. You can add more to this life meter by collecting the heart items that are found throughout stages. Right below this number on the top left is the time limit. And this is your typical accomplish the goal before the time runs out, or you lose a life and have to start over again deal. In this game though, I never actually ran out of time at any time during my gameplay, as the stages are so short as it is. So the time was kind of a waste of time due to how straightforward things were. They don't even put in any items to add more time, if that tells you how worthless having a time limit in this game truly is. On the bottom left of the screen is your extra lives display. As long as you have extra lives, continue on with the stage with your progress that you made still saved. But once you lose all your lives, you have to do the start of the stage all over again, and you don't get unlimited continues in this game. There's an item you have to pick up, the green colored leaves, that will give you extra continues. You can also get extra lives by picking up Mowgli shaped head item. Unlike other games where you can stack up a lot of lives quickly, this game's lives and continues are very hard to come by at many points, but the easier gameplay does make up for this. The last display on the screen, and it's shown at all times, is on the bottom right corner, and this is the gem tally. And there are some stages that require you to collect all the gems on it before you can progress to the next one, which turns these type of stages into a typical hunt and collect situation. For every orange gem you find, the counter goes up by 1. You find all the needed ones, the stage ends. It's a weird display in that there are a lot of stages of the game that don't require any gems to be found, but it's important for the stages that do require it, of course, so you can keep track of your progress all the while. And that's it for on-screen displays. There's actually a score display in this game, but it's only visible when the game is paused, and that'll be shown right in the center of the screen, with the number below that showing how many continues you have remaining. The score on this game, again, doesn't do much, so I can see why they keep it hidden. You get huge score tallies when the stage ends, and they add up how well you did, but you wouldn't even know the score existed if you didn't pause the game every now and then. There are various items in the game, but they are very limiting and short-term use. You can't actually cycle through the weapons in this game, a feature prominent in later versions. A lot of the items are found by using your weapon on bunches of bananas hanging overhead. Once they break apart, an item is revealed. You can get things such as extra lives, hearts, mask that will give you temporary invincibility, and 2 weapon upgrades. One of these upgrades is a boomerang that will change your weapon to that until you lose a life or the stage ends, where it changes back to the default banana. And the other weapon type is double bananas that will change your weapon into rapid firing bananas for a very short period of time. Sadly, besides the boomerang upgrade, all the other items are not even worth the effort to find, as they are so short-lived you don't even get to make any use out of them. I definitely feel they should have made better use of these items, but not even bother in the first place if they're just going to be for points, short-lived, or so scarce in the game's run. There was no joy that one usually gets in finding a weapon upgrade, as you knew it wasn't going to last for long, and that is definitely a downside for this game that could have easily been avoided. The enemy types in this game are all animal-based, and the usual assortment as well. You have monkeys in trees, as well as monkeys on the ground, annoying bees, annoying birds, snakes, scorpions, rolling armadillos, and of course bats. And all these can only be defeated with your equipped weapon, mostly the banana, with no jumping on top of them being available this time around. Thank goodness you get unlimited supplies of the fruit-based weapon, but each enemy has different amounts of hits to defeat it, so it can be a little tricky at times. Like other versions of games based on this movie, the enemies don't respawn unless you lose a life or continue, which is also a good thing, of course, that I wish more games followed suit on. But at least there was a nice variety here, and not just the same assortment again and again. As mentioned earlier, there are a few types of stages found in the 11 stages of this game, and they all mostly play out similarly, with just how to end the stage being the only real difference to take note of. The game's first few stages have a collect the gem objective, and that's all you really have to do during these stages. Climb vines, swing through vines, explore ledges, take out enemies, and be sure to collect any gem you see along the way by jumping at it as it hangs above. They will add some other elements as the game goes along, like the second stage has lizard tongues that you have to jump on to climb up higher, trees to explore with lots of holes to walk and jump throughout, and spring plants to help boost you up along the way. All the while, your goal is still to collect every gem you can find to have the stage suddenly end. And again, I'm not sure what the significance of these gems are, as they really didn't play any part in the movie to be important. Later stages will change the setting and backgrounds, but the missions stay the same. Whether it's a monkey village with huts to walk through, collapsing bridges to jump across, or a nighttime setting with all sorts of creatures out to get you, goal remains the same for these type of stages. Collect the gems to move on to the next one, which is either straightforward or difficult, depending on how easily you can find some of the harder to get ones. The second type of stage objective is Find Bagheera, and you would think this would be easier, as instead of collecting gems, you just have to find the lazy cat. But of course, these stages are much longer in length, and he is usually only found at the end of said adventuring throughout the stage. So you do everything you did on the prior moments of the gem collecting stages without worrying of actually collecting the gems this time. Just make it to the end alive, and wherever he is residing, touch him and the stage ends. But there's also some stage type variations within these type of stages. The biggest one being river stages that has Mowgli traveling down the river with you jumping onto ledges and also hopping onto turtle shells, alligators, and disappearing logs in the river. Avoid enemies of all types trying to get at you. Lots of item collecting and jumps required to get through this properly as you avoid falling to your doom all the while. But strangely enough, there are gems found in some of these stages too that'll just give you points for all your effort. To mix it up even further, they have an even harder river stage with Baloo now involved, and you have to use him as a platform to get you through the areas you can't venture through otherwise. You have to avoid whirlpools, enemies, and hippos, while making hard-to-make jumps and leaps while trying to collect items that are on ledges well above you. And again, all you have to do is make it to the end of this long obstacle course to move on. That's really how most of this game will go. You're really doing the same things for most of it, and not much variety mixed in, and a lot of the stages seem to be trapped in a box, meaning that you can reach invisible boundaries that you can't walk past, making for a very short stage, no matter which type of stage variation it is. It's only these select few different stages that take you to a village or a river that'll give some uniqueness to this whole experience. Too bad though that the constantly side-scrolling type of stages are much harder to deal with than the regular platform-based ones. And speaking of constantly side-scrolling stages, that is basically what the next type of stage found in the game is. And it's only one stage, and that's a bonus stage of sorts. It's a nod to the Elephant Dawn Patrol, and we get a stage that is a bonus stage and serves as nothing else but a bonus stage. The third stage will start you off on a different looking stage that is constantly moving, and you have to keep up with it by jumping atop of the elephants as they continue to march along the bottom. You have to get over huge gaps by using platforms and spring plants in the hopes of catching items and vines to keep your momentum going. The stage will end instantly if you fall to your doom, get hit, or can't keep up with the stage. You don't lose a life, you just move on to the next stage with no chance to repeat it. No matter where or when it happens, it just ends. Your one and only chance in the game to get a lot of important items. And of course it can get tricky at times, and given you have just one chance to do this stage, it doesn't leave much time for practice or mistakes. I thought it was an interesting stage and really offered something different in the game. It's just too bad it appears so early in the game, and the only time something like this actually showed up. The location for these 11 stages do match up well enough to the movie, or as well as can be expected for an old school 8-bit based system. Early stages in the game focus on the jungle and trees, with Ka the Snake found within. Then you have the bonus stage which focuses on the Dawn Patrol. Two more stages after that, which will have the river and Baloo. Then it's on to the tree village and ruins, with the focus being King Louie's domain. And then you deal with the jungle at night as you work your way towards the end, final confrontation with Shere Khan at night in the jungle. So yeah, it's all here and in the proper order too. But the stages are so confining and short, you don't get much flavor or feel to situations. Besides in areas like the river and bonus stage, which do seem to be more drawn out and offer some variety over the other cookie-cutter type of stages, that'll just change some colors here and there for differences, rather than really having a unique personality to capture the moments from the movie. The graphics are as good as can be expected for a Game Gear or Master System game. Nothing spectacular, but it is clear to see what characters are which, and colors are used well enough to give differences in time periods and settings. There are no cutscenes, and everything is kept basic, with in-between stage moments just being black backgrounds with simple text on it to show you your point tallies. But then you have stages like the before-mentioned Dawn Patrol that's a very interesting style, and probably graphically looks the best of anything else in this game. You can tell who each character is, and see that a vine is a vine and the water is definitely water. So it accomplished what it had to with what it had to work with, but it's nothing special. Play controls are hit and miss in this game. The Game Gear's version controls are improved over the Master System's version of the same game, but as for the initial version, the controls definitely needed a lot of work. And it's mostly the jump-based problems, as per usual with games based on this movie, that'll lead to most of your frustrations. Mowgli moves with the direction pad, either left or right, or he pushes up to climb up and down to duck down, depending on which direction is pushed. One button will fire the weapon, while the other button jumps. It doesn't get any simpler than that. The jump aspects are all over the place though in this game, very inaccurate and poor. Missing jumps to platforms and ledges, and even going through said objects due to poor detection. Missing vines that you clearly jumped at and touched. And not to mention all sorts of fun with those spring plants that seem to randomly shoot you higher or not as high as you needed to get to those hard to reach areas that can only be reached through these spring plant methods. You can move Mowgli faster by holding the direction that he's moving, and then you have to time a jump while he's moving fast onto a spring to make the whole situation work out well. If these jumping and hit detection moments were even a little better, this would have been a much better game. At least they improved it on the Game Gear version, but it should have been that way and even better for its initial release, as this is not a fun experience to go through due to all of this. There are boss battles in this version of the Jungle Book, and it's the usual suspects you expect. Ka the Snake battles you in the trees. Two separate fights later on in the game with King Louie in two separate stages. And these fights are as simplistic as it gets, probably the most simplistic out of any version of the game based off of this movie. Ka the Snake, for instance, will appear on one side of the screen, moving towards you. You have to jump on a spring plant over him, avoiding his one eye shot at you, and keep blasting your bananas at him. Repeat, repeat, repeat until you finish him off. King Louie battles will differ a bit, but are the same idea in both battles. The first time you fight him, he'll be on one of two ledges, and he'll jump down from the initial ledge he's on to the other one. As he jumps down, rocks will fall from the ceiling in the process. Avoid him and the rocks, and fire at him repeatedly until he's defeated. The second time you fight him, there's only one platform now in the middle of the stage that he'll jump from, so you have less space to work with and avoid, but it's still the same idea. Keep firing until he's taken out, and avoid all the spam in the process. The boss battles were far from tough, and came off as very bad Mega Man Robot Master battles with how pattern-based and simplistic they came off. I'm not saying they were too easy, as they had a bit of a challenge, but for all your hard work to get to these points, it just seemed unfulfilling when all was said and done. The game itself is only 30 to 60 minutes long, depending on how good a run you're having. Once you make it to stage 10, you are nearing the climax of the game. This stage is a nighttime stage that is more of the same of climbing vines and platforming and dealing with enemies as you look for those 8 hidden gems again to move on to the end of the game. And this stage will really test your wits and use of poor play controls for all it's worth, as you have to jump from broken bridges and finding yourself falling back down to lower levels as you miss time and time again. Thank goodness they give you a lot of time to work with and enemies don't return once you defeat them. But once you do finally get all 8 of these hard to get gems, the game brings you to the confrontation with the movie's main antagonist of Shere Khan, as it's you versus the big cat once and for all. And believe it or not, this is one of the easiest final boss battle situations ever. You are automatically equipped with a fire branch, a la the movie, and you toss them in an arch in front of you. There'll be fires on the ground and above burning as they show up in pattern-like formation. Jump above or below to the other area where the fire isn't and just keep on attacking Shere Khan's tail. Again, a la the movie. When the tail disappears, then you have to hit his head over and over again by jumping an attack while still avoiding those same flames above and below. Shere Khan never moves for an instant from the spot in the center of the stage. The game will suddenly end just like that, and you'll find the one cutscene moment of the entire game, and this shows Mowgli and the village girl meeting each other in a still capture before showing a final score tally on a black screen. That is followed by a brief credit scroll before it fades back to the start. And well, that's it.
All the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean the bare necessities, or Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life.
That matches. Bare Necessities matches, but it's really the only song that is focused on here. They do use I Want to Be Like You in select moments, but it really was Bare Necessities that gets the main focus for this game. And that song is used as a remix version and a slower beat version a few times in the game's run. But the most of the rest of the music, besides the songs mentioned, being generic, situational songs to fit the moments of the game. Later games based on this film would do it better, and they seemed to get it more right as the games got released. This version, though, could have been a little bit better music-wise. The boss fight music, for instance, is just a repetitive beat, and with 11 stages to work with, it would have been nice to get more songs or feel the film's soundtrack, besides going back to the same song various times. For the first game based on this animated adventure, it's not terrible, really. It's a very no-frills basic type of game that has a lot of control issues holding it back. But any fan of the film that this is based on should get the feel that this is going for. As it does keep true to the story as best as it can on this type of format, it's a very general platformer that does offer some bits of variety. You could say that they got all they could out of the Master System, and even tried to improve it slightly on the Game Gear a year later. There are many things this game has going for it. It bases well off the movie, and follows the movie order of moments in comparison quite well. Has familiar music, and characters, and an easy to understand game for the most part, that anyone of all age can play without dealing with too much difficulty. But the small box-like trapped area stages, poor play control moments, lack of weapons and items that are of any use or longevity, and easy and simplistic boss battles are all things that can't be ignored. There's no reason why a game like this should have been rushed and incomplete, as it's based off a movie that hasn't been in theaters for so many years prior. It has the makings of a good game based off the Jungle Book, but it comes off as a good first attempt that needed some more polish and work done on it before it was actually released. I can see why the other versions changed things so much away from this one, adding more elements and gameplay over this initial effort. I realize that the Master System is limited, but I also knew there was a lot of great games on that system that are all able to pull off things much better than what we wound up with this game. It's not a bad game at all, but it's not a great game, or even as good as it should have been. After going through this for a few stages, you get to feel what the whole game is about and realize it's not that much. I think that says it all. It's a good start to the games based off of this movie, but far from the best or enjoyable. If anything, it's just as average as the NES version, just not as complete as that game was, as it lacks so much in comparison. Well, either way, that's another one done for games based on this film, and so far none have really been that impressive. We'll see how our next version does in another review in the future. I find it more amazing that there are so many different versions all based off this initial game in the first place. While I don't think it should be burned like Shere Khan was, it's definitely something that won't keep your attention long, and other versions definitely pull it off better. And this game is going to wind up getting a... That's all for this edition of Movies to Video Games Review. Please be sure to check back soon for our next video game based on a